sitting through and listening to the two of us. What we're here to present is an application that we built using our company's technology to tell stories from Chicago crime data. So first off, just who we are. My name's Dan Platt. I've been in narrative science since a few months after the company started in 2010. I come from a background of journalism. I graduated from Northwestern from Medill, and I'm here and chose to work to build this application because I believe that what our company does and what our technology can do can help give the public a better understanding of its community and potentially help municipalities do more with its data.
Yep, and my name's Craig Booth. I've been at narrative science for almost a year now. Prior to that, I was a researcher in astrophysics and high-performance computing at the University of Chicago. And in doing that, I realized that the thing I loved most about doing research was taking big blobs of opaque data and figuring out the interesting things in there and then figuring out how to show those things to people. So I made the decision to move to narrative science 10 months ago. And yeah, that decision is also related to me being stuck here right now.
And so this is a little bit about our company and some of the clients that we've worked with. So like I said, we started in 2010. The technology started out of Northwestern University. We have 50 customers. It also has our venture partners. This is a sales slide. This isn't a sales audience, but I just wanted to give kind of an overall background of what our company is. This is kind of a more interesting example of what we do. One of the companies that we have worked with is in supply chain management for a very large fast food franchise. They spent thousands, millions of dollars to put together software that gave franchisees access to all sorts of reports and dashboards and spreadsheets that tracked all of the food that this store sold and every store in that company. They got less than like 10% adoption from people because this stuff is very hard to understand. But what we did is we took all of that data and turned it into something like this. So again, being able to take all of those spreadsheets and kind of boil it all down into a paragraph or a couple of sentences that just gives someone some insight into how they're doing. And so we were able to do this at scale. And generate reports like this in under a second for each store. So those are just some examples. So before we present our app that used civic data, just briefly where this project came from. We did our own internal hackathon where people were left to their own devices to use our technology to build fun stuff. Craig and I chose to take advantage of our interest in civic causes and Chicago's open data to try to make something using our technology. So that's where this came from. And this is the app.
Yep, do you want me to take over here?
Yes.
Okay, so just to give you a very, very brief overview of what things are going to look like when it's finished, and I'll say a few bits about how it works, where the data comes from. It is a web app, it's a website you can visit. The website has one box on it. You write some sort of address in the box, just something that identifies a place somewhere in Chicago. You wait for a few seconds, and what comes back is a story about crimes in that neighborhood, in the surrounding neighborhoods, how that neighborhood stacks up against similar neighborhoods, how it stacks up against different neighborhoods in terms of the types of crimes that happen, where they happen, when they happen. So we can just sort of call out a few of the things we talk about here. So this is for a story written about the loop. It compares the loop to the most different neighborhoods it can find in terms of the mean income of the people who live there. It talks about the different types of crimes that happen in those different neighborhoods. Also takes a quick look at when crimes happen in your neighborhood relative to Chicago as a whole. So I'm going quite fast, but so you can see what the input of this thing looks like. This is what the city of Chicago gives you. The city of Chicago make available a CSV file with one row for every crime that's happened in Chicago, at least reported crime, since 2001. So this is a CSV with about 600,000 lines. There are some identifiers. There is a time that the crime happened, a rough address that it happened at, the type of the crime, and most interestingly, all the way over here, the place where that crime happened. So I'm going to run through just sort of in the form of a flowchart and try and give you sort of a qualitative feel for how the data flows around this application, what data it needs to work. So it is a web app, as we said on the last slide. So this right here, your browser, this is you sitting at a computer. You type in a URL, your browser says, give me the website, the application server says, okay. You can see that box on the web page. You type in some sort of address or something into the box, your browser does not send that straight back to the application server, it reaches out to the Google Maps geocoding API, sends some string, in this case, my home address. The Google Maps API returns a latitude and longitude, says, this is the place you're talking about, and your browser sends, this is the place I'm talking about, to the application server. So this is what goes into writing one of these stories, along with a bunch of stuff from the City of Chicago data portal. So we need three separate data sources. The first is we need the list of community boundaries. So all of the open data you can get is basically split down by ward. But you know, anyone who lives here doesn't really care what ward they live in unless they're actively trying to complain at an alderman. So we find the boundaries of every community area. We also bring down, for each of these community areas, the census information. So what fraction of the houses in that neighborhood are below the poverty limit? What is the average income? How did the population change over the past 10 years? And then the final thing that goes into this is this CSV of all of the crimes that have happened. So the application server ships this then off for some data processing. There's quite a bit that goes into this step. So I've blown this green box out into one entire slide here. There's kind of a lot going on, so I'll talk through it. So the first two things that come in right here are the place you want to write the story about and this data file full of all of the community boundaries. And what we do then is we just map the crime to a neighborhood. And this sort of came out of some work I did a little while ago. So this is a map I made by bringing down about 500,000 geotagged tweets in Chicago, doing a very basic form of sentiment analysis on each one. So how kind of happy or kind of sad is this tweet? Putting them into neighborhoods and then asking how kind of happy, at least in terms of the language they use in tweets, or kind of sad is each neighborhood? And what drops out is this, that apparently when you're talking about tweets, the near north side is relatively happy, the south side is relatively sad. You can even see, for example, Hyde Park down here is like a little beacon of happiness. So we run these latitudes and longitudes through this, and we get this is a place in the loop. We also take this entire crime CSV, run this through the same thing. We know now which neighborhood each of the crimes happened in. And the third source of information that comes into the computation is the census information. So as I said, just some information about every one of the neighborhoods we may want to talk about. And we throw this all here into some big black box that I've just called computation. I don't really have time to run through what all of the computation is, but it's probably worth thinking of it in these terms. What we need to do right now, we just have a pile of data. What we want to get out of this is a story about interesting things. So we need to figure out some way of defining what are the interesting things. This is the editorial configuration, and this is where Dan comes back in.
So, awesome. So yeah, so all of the stuff that Craig showed is awesome and super cool, and I have no clue how to do it, but it only gets us so far if we want to have an app that tells stories about crimes in the city. So putting on the journalist hat, what I do is I go and talk to someone like Craig about this story and come with some questions that a journalist would ask. So what is the story that I want to tell? I want to report about crimes in Chicago neighborhoods. Who's the audience for this story? Is it a concerned citizen who wants to type in their address and get a story, or is it someone who works at City Hall? Is it a public official? Those things matter, because your story is gonna look different for those audiences. In this case, we made it for concerned citizens. How can we find relevant insights about crime in any neighborhood? I had taken a stab at doing something similar a few years ago, where I wrote a story just about an individual ward, because I wasn't able to do the plotting of the neighborhoods, and just talk about how crimes changed in that neighborhood. But really, that's kind of in a vacuum. So what we need is more information to make what we're reporting on relevant. So in this case, I need to know maybe other neighborhoods and relevant neighborhoods that I could compare to this one, so you really know how that neighborhood is doing in terms of crime, and also compare it to the city overall. And then the last question is, now that I've laid out all of these requirements, do I actually have the data that I need to tell this story? And in this case, the answer is yes.
All right, so back to this slide. So this editorial configuration that comes here is basically the description of the things you're interested in the story and the things you're interested in saying about them. So although I can't really go into any detail right now about how this works, what drops out of the end is a blob of data. So all the way back now to this slide, this blob of data flies out of the data processing thing and hits Quill, the artificial intelligence story writing platform we use. Now Quill is very, very nice. It has an API. So you throw some data at Quill. As long as Quill knows to expect this sort of data, what happens is it throws back a story in either HTML or text or whatever you want. That story comes all the way back to your browser and is rendered as a story about the neighborhood you asked about. So we seem to be doing okay on time,
yeah.
Right? Okay, so yeah. So just to sort of sidetrack for a little while, so the most interesting thing I think about this is not really that it is a story about crime in Chicago, but that in everything we've said, we've not really talked about crime in Chicago. This is just data about a thing. So this story right here is a story about neighborhoods compared to other neighborhoods, and neighborhoods have crime. It could equally well be a story about Twitter users compared to other Twitter users. Twitter users have tweets. Or a story about stores compared to other stores. Stores have transactions. Or a story about Divvy stations compared to other Divvy stations. Divvy stations have journeys that end there. Again, like sports teams, and sports teams compared to other teams, sports teams have results. And we've done exactly this process with something called Quill Connect, which should be launched at some point, which basically does the same as this crime story, but it's a story about you on Twitter. So this is a picture of another website here. You go to this website, you hit get started, you hook up your Twitter account, and what it returns a few minutes later is this. This is a story about how you behave on Twitter. It looks So it looks at you, it looks at your 100 most recent followers. It downloads your tweets, it downloads all of their tweets. It looks at the topics you seem to be tweeting about, the sentiments in those tweets, and it begins to pick out the relevant cohorts that are interesting, that should be interesting to write about, and tells you about them. So this one in particular is about me. So look at your history. You focus most on politics, travel, and sports. Well, of your followers who are more similar to you, they also tweet a lot about politics. There, I can't read. You know, the text is right up there. You can. but the interesting point here is that this is essentially the same as talking about crimes that happen in a neighborhood. So that's it. We're going to put the URL for the app up on the screen so anyone who is interested can have a play around with it. We've never load tested this thing before, so if it dies, sorry. And do you want to?
Yeah, sure. So just to conclude, what our beliefs are and why we're here is we believe that narratives are not a clear substitution for visualizations or other ways of doing data work. We think that narratives can be a great complement in a lot of cases to visualizations or charts and graphs. I think in some cases they're probably a better way of explaining information, and probably in some ways you're better with a pie chart or something. But we believe that they are a very useful way of taking very complex data sets and putting them in a format that people can understand. We also believe that aside from the crime story that we built, that there are so many stories that can be told from civic data. So not just the data that the city of Chicago makes available, but maybe data that parts of the city or other municipalities or the federal government make available. So this is an example of something else that came out of our hackathon, where somebody took the metrics of water temperature and wrote a story about the beaches in Chicago to find which were the cleanest. I believe it's 63rd Street Beach is the cleanest. So yeah, this is another example of taking data and doing fun stuff. And then the last thing is, if people have ideas of stories that they want to tell, and they've done data work and want to use that data to maybe tell stories, because I think narratives might be a useful way to do that, you should come and talk with Craig and I, because we this is something we're interested in also. That's why we're here. So we'd love to chat about it. And then that's the link if you want to type in an address or a neighborhood or something and write a story. Thank you.
So thank you.
Awesome.
Time for some questions if anybody has questions for this, these guys.
Sure.
A couple, but you can choose to just answer one. The first is that you talked just a little bit at the end of the presentation about the fact that stories have their place and also infographics or images have their place in analyzing data. Mm-hmm. Do you have any sort of broad stroke indications of which of those would be the best way to talk about data in different cases?
Like a specific case?
However you want to address it.
I'm not sure. I'm partial to stories because I like to write and I love what we do. I can't think off the top of my head of a case where I would love...
Would be better.
Yeah, but I'm sure, I know that there are, so I can't think of
that. Well, so on a very general level, if you make a visualization, that visualization potentially tells you many, many thousands of things. It's up to the person looking at the visualization to interpret it however they want. The thing about stories, differently to that, is they are very, very good at, if you have something that you know you want to get out of this data, actually putting it in front of you so you can just read it. It makes certain things very, very clear in that respect.
I could comment on that. Like, one of the things that I thought of was Derek's app about campaign finance, and this seems like a great application to make campaign financing data more easily read by the public. It's just candidate X received more from this group of donors than this candidate. Oh. You know, that's like a very clear narrative story.
Yeah, I mean, when we were discussing this hackathon project, one of the things that actually came up was trying to do the TIFF funding, because that data is freely available, but really like unusable in the form it's available in.
This is only sort of a half-formed question in my head, so forgive me if it doesn't work. But how much were you concerned when writing this application about giving subjective spin to the narratives that it spits out in terms of like presenting raw data versus presenting a narrative? It seems a lot easier to skew it.
Yeah, in this particular case, I really wasn't worried at all, because what we pretty much created was just a report on crime statistics. So I was going to write what the system was going to write what the numbers say. We have customers that we work with where we write like recaps of Little League baseball games. I probably might be a little bit worried that I may misclassify a game as being a really bad one for a pitcher, and then having the lead of the story talk about how crappy the pitcher was when maybe he wasn't really crappy. So then I might be worried about having subjective spin. But in this case, it was pretty much just a report on the stats and just a more digestible way of taking all those spreadsheets and displaying them to people.
And is there intentionally a sort of a level of spin you can add? Like, if you are particularly writing, if you are writing for a particular client and you want to be able to address their concerns specifically, is that something that you can feed, you know, you can...
Yes, we are capable of doing that. I know what you're asking, but the example I will use is another sports example where, again, we write stories about baseball games. Mm-hmm. There is a winning team and there is a losing team, and oftentimes it's a Little League game. And you have parents reading those stories. And so if your team lost, you probably don't want to spend your 400 words reading about how awesome the winning team was.
Right.
So we're able to create our stories for a particular audience. So in this case, two people score the same game. The company's called Game Changer. They score the same game on an application, and they get two different stories. The losing parent gets a story on the losing team that talks about the player who, you know, valiantly went 1-for-4 with a single, and the team lost 10-0. And then the winning team talks about, you know, the guy who had 5 home runs and the team blew out the other team 10-0. So, like, yes, we that's one of the things I take pride in about our software, is that we can do that. But I know what you're asking, and I'm sure it could be used for that too, I'm sure.
I actually was not leading in any way at all. I meant to add face value. All
right, then maybe on the
I'm curious, kind of along those lines, does the application, you tell it what types of things you're looking for, and it's going to tell it to you no matter what the data is, or is it specifically finding things that meet a certain threshold or a certain significant difference or something more intelligent?
It's up to the user. So, yeah, you can put in filters. Yeah, so in this case, we wanted to write a very similar story about every single neighborhood. But hypothetically, like, you could have a certain paragraph write in a certain way for certain neighborhoods, and maybe have that paragraph write another way for other neighborhoods, or maybe not show up at all. Our software that we use, so people like me work and configure it, is very flexible. And based on what our customers' needs are, we can do any of those sort of permutations.
Kind of following up to that, does the software take like sample size into account? Like, if you're asking for something that is not significant, like, would it still give you a comparison that might not really mean anything?
That's what the data processing step at the start does have an aspect of human intervention. It's on people like me to make sure we say no things that are too stupid.
In the beginning, you mentioned that you got a lot of tweets to do this happiness.
Oh, yes, yes.
Is that related to the overall result?
So this was just an aside I made. It was just that I happened to have developed the code that moved the latitude and longitude to the community area it was in. For a different project, and I had a pretty picture, so I showed it. Okay. Not related to this at all.
As a follow-up, a buddy of mine works in San Francisco in a company called NetBase Solutions, whose job is to look at tweets so they can tell the company how people are perceiving their brands. I've been told that it's a very complex algorithm with many PhDs in linguistics working on it. How did you do yours?
So you've been told correctly, and what I did was the very, very dumbest thing. I added up the number of happy-sounding words from a dictionary that psychologists made, subtracted the number of unhappy-sounding words, took the overall number, and I think, and this is, you know, this is an approach you do see in the literature in places. It doesn't work overly well, but the amount of work you have to put in to achieve even a small like increase in accuracy over that is more than I was willing to do for a stupid map I put on my blog.
Do the crime statistics, do they calculate negative control per capita so that you can create stories that actually compare not just the volume of crime, but the rate of crime?
So we discussed this a fair amount, and if you look at the stories, most of the comparisons are done by ranking the crimes in an individual neighborhood. So in this, we just looked at raw numbers. We do have the numbers to do this per capita. But for example, we were very careful not to make claims like the most crime-ridden neighborhood is X, because all we were doing was summing up numbers of crimes. So we're very explicit about that. This was,
Where do you get most traction, from public or private?
I mean, most of our companies are in the private sector. We do some work with government customers as well, but I mean, most of our work is in financial services. You know, just places where there's tons of data that you could try to make sense of. So a few like mutual fund companies where they need to write like quarterly attribution summaries to investors about how the funds are doing. And so we're able to take all of that data and generate a story that tells you that the, you know, telecommunications sector was the driver of your outperformance of the Russell 1000 or something. So most of it is in that space. Yeah?
Sort of piggybacking on that, I think you mentioned that all of your work, all of your partnerships require someone on your team to facilitate that work, some sort of engagement analyst.
For now.
Do you have a plan to go direct to consumer? And if so, obviously if so, yes. What are the challenges keeping you from that at present?
But yeah, I mean, it's definitely something we plan on doing. We feel that our platform is probably going to be best used by I can't even think what people in this room would want to do with it, and it's super exciting. You know, our company's not that old, and so we had this technology that originally was very complicated to use because it did this really cool thing, and we're still trying to take that and make it into something that we'd be ready to share with consumers. And so there's a lot of like user experience work that like has to go into that. But that's the stuff that we are like actively working on like today. I don't know why so many people are here. Probably should be doing that.
I want to make sure I heard something right at the beginning. So you said you asked a series of questions.
Mm-hmm.
So you didn't have to like write a set of articles as training data. You just made questions and then out come these reports.
I wrote questions and then Craig and I had a powwow and we both did some configuration to generate the stories.
I mean, like it still seems like magic.
Yeah.
So the level of the configuration for these particular stories is you define what are the cohorts you're interested in. Say, I live in neighborhood X. What are the cohorts of neighborhoods I want to compare to? Say, the richest neighborhoods or the most nearby neighborhoods or the neighborhoods that are most similar by types of crime. So you define the types of things you want to compare to. And then we say, for this cohort, these are the things we want to look at. That's the level of configuration. These are the things we want to compare to. This is what we want to look at.
But there were no sentences that you're plugging in.
And then we also do configure the language.
Okay, if it was doing the language.
No, it's not doing the language from scratch.
No.
Okay.
However, once it's like done and we've been like, we're finished, like you type in an address and you get a story and I didn't do anything. That's how it works. Yeah.
Theoretically, how far can you take this? Can you write, do you envision that you'll be able to write whole books? Fiction, nonfiction?
Not me. I don't know how to answer that. I mean, I've always believed that the possibilities are really endless for what we can do. It really just depends if people have data and there's a story they want to tell. And so these happen to be like 500 word stories, but I don't see why not if someone had a bunch of data and wanted to tell a 5-volume opus about something that they couldn't use our software to do that. I don't know. Yeah, in the back.
It is election season. Have you had any ideas towards marketing in that direction?
We actually did a project around the last election. I think it was in, we worked with the New York Times. We did some like campaign finance stuff. We used the New York Times API to write campaign finance stories. So it's definitely something that we have done and think is interesting. We'd love to do again. Yeah, sure.
Okay. So is there an analytics piece that kind of goes into trying to make the text most effective to the user? So maybe with the finance reports that you're generating, do you have any changes in your text based off of how long someone is like reading it on a website, for example?
For that specific case, no. Right now, we're pretty hands-on, you know, with our customers, and so based on what their goals are for their content, we work with them to make the story sound the way they want it to. But I can envision a world where, you know, we generated a story, we saw how long somebody, you know, read a certain paragraph, and so then the next time they go to that web page, we make sure that they get a different version of that paragraph or something.
Because you're essentially guessing with this crime data what people
Yeah, I mean, I am guessing. If there was actually like a market, I guess, for these, it would be awesome to talk to someone who's like responsible for reporting crime and talk to them about what they think is interesting, and then we could make our system write that. But until we do that, we're left with my best guess in the far back.
I have three quick questions for you. You can find the only or one of the two journalists here. So my first question is, are you trying to take away my job?
No!
Are you guys working with any newsrooms at all? Can you talk a little more about how you guys really massage the language and how important that works?
Sure. So first off, no. We wholeheartedly believe that our technology is not meant to supplant journalists from doing their jobs. I think at the beginning of our company, it was a lot easier maybe to think that because we had worked a lot in like the media space. But really what we're doing now, most of our work, journalists aren't doing. We're working for private companies, large financial firms to take large sets of data and tell stories from it. So a person who maybe got laid off from the Trib wasn't doing that. So I don't think that at all. The second question was if we're working with any like newsrooms. No. The third one, how we massage the language. Again, based on the story we want to tell, maybe requirements we get from our customers about how they phrase certain things, we take that as well as the skills of a lot of really good writers that we have at our company, people that are very good at writing but are also very good at using our software, and those are the people that create the language that goes into the reports. Sure.
Okay, I had a question. Have you guys ever thought about maybe in between the articles that show up, putting like some sort of, based off of, I guess the way the person speaks or thinks, you know, put like a joke in between everything, like, wow, that's a lot of, you know, whatever. You know, have you ever thought about doing that, like putting a joke in between, or you know, like side comments added to it based off the person's interests?
Like a sarcastic. Yeah. Well, programming sarcasm is somewhat difficult. But yeah, I mean, I think that if there's something that's in the data that would allow us to make a snarky
right.
comment, then yeah, we probably could do that.
So were you guys thinking of maybe giving a personality quiz at the beginning of the ad?
I like it.
It's a good idea.
Yeah.
So having not gotten a chance to read through a whole story,
yeah.
Can't really tell if it's just like a kind of a series of factoids and sentences, or if there really is like an overarching roll-up of a summary that one would get from all the factoids. So my question would be like, is part of your software, or do you plan for part of your software to be like, having written all of these factoids in the sentences, what is like the big takeaway here? Or what are the three, you know, how we learn to write when we're in like elementary school,
yeah.
It's like you have the topic sentence, then you have evidence, like,
yeah.
Is that part of
it? Yeah, I mean, it's stuff that we do already. Like I said, it really all depends on the type of story we want to tell. For the crime story, since the data is pretty like dense, like yes, it is much. It reads probably more like a bunch of factoids. But like again, our sports stories, where it's much more like light, just like I would do as a sports writer. My first paragraph before I dig into anything statistical talks about the biggest thing in like the biggest overarching theme in this game. Was it a defensive battle? Was it a comeback or whatever? And that's like the first paragraph before I even mention a number at all. So we do both.
How do you know that from the data?
Oh, that's the fun part. I mean, that's the favorite part of my job. And
fantastic catch is just an out.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, so yeah, a fantastic catch is an out. So those are things that we like constantly look to try to do better. So like we do hockey stories like I was able to write some language that appears in our hockey stories that knows when like two people got into a fight and were both ejected from the game. And that's literally all sitting in the data, which is kind of interesting. So like we're constantly trying to get better at that. And also sports leagues and companies that do data are working to put more of that stuff actually in tabular form. So like MLB, like their, you know, pitch tracks and stuff. Like, you know the X, Y, and Z coordinate of the ball at each point from pitcher's hand to plate. So, like, if you know that, then you can probably talk about a wicked curveball versus just a regular crappy curveball or fastball.
Just to add on to that, baseball, they have a track man system now that actually tracks the fielders, and it generates, like, 7 terabytes of data for every game. And so you would be able to know.
So yeah, we'll get better as they get better. That's the fun part. Cool. In the back, right there.
Going from your sports analogy to a political analogy.
Sure.
Are you saying that if I send in a thing which says, "Tell me what's bad about Obamacare," someone else can send in a thing, "Tell us why the Affordable Health Care Act is a good thing," and you can come up with two stories which are completely different based on the based on the same numbers.
Yes. Assuming there was something good or bad to say, you know, like to say about it, then yes. I think it would probably work the same way. We haven't done that. No one's asked for it. But yeah, I would see that working in the same way.
So the first thing I thought about, first of all, I just think this is pretty cool.
Thanks.
But the first thing I thought about when I saw this was sort of a rising field of adaptive documentaries and how you can sort of take quizzes for certain documentaries in the beginning, and it sort of shows the, it kind of shows a different outcome based on who you are and how you answer questions. And so I guess I just wanted to know how you are incorporating film or photography into some of the stories that you are telling, just as the world becomes more visual when it comes to the narrative medium.
Currently as a company, not very much, but some of the stuff that I've experimented in has been with, actually, people have talked about GIS, like using like Esri or other like imaging or map type systems to take that and write stories about things like maps. So that's kind of like the closest we've gotten to that, because even something like a map, which is very visual, like there really is underlying data to that. You know, like if you have a bunch of points or lines or polygons on a map, like there are data points that are the lat longs of all those points or the distance between two places or stuff like that. So you could hypothetically take that image and write a story about it. And that's kind of, that I've played with some of that stuff, but that's like the closest we've come to that. Yeah, sure. I was waiting for that. I was just going to go until you told me to stop.
I was wondering if you had any clients when you were approached by anyone from the fantasy baseball sector? Because that's a bunch of people who have data and their stories.
Yeah. We've definitely done that work before. We're not doing it currently. We actually did a project for... as part of our work with the Big Ten Network, where they worked with a site called What If Sports, where you pick two teams from any like era, and they play each other in a fictional game. And so we took those and we wrote recaps about it. So like to know that like Jackie Robinson hit the winning home run when the 48 Dodgers played against, you know, Derek Jeter and the 06 Yankees or something. So we did something like that, which was kind of cool. Thank you.